divergent and convergent thinking, right? So by ideation, what we did was we went into a divergent thinking mode. We created a lot of ideas. We have, let's say, assuming that, you know, someone has 8 ideas, someone has 10, someone has 15, someone has 25. So what is the next step is to pick an idea, which you will then prototype, okay? So typically, this is where you kind of converge again. It doesn't matter which idea you pick. Ideally, in an ideal world, you use this framework to pick an idea. So what do I mean by that? You pick an idea which is desirable, viable, and feasible, and in that order, okay? So I'll repeat again. In an ideal world, you pick ideas that are desirable, viable, and feasible, and in that order. So desirability comes the first. Any reasons, anyone can guess why desirability is at the top or the first criteria? Exactly, adoption, right? If the people for whom you're trying to solve the problem, if they don't like it, there's not going to be any adoption, right? That is the reason why we say first thing is desirable. So it should, the user for whom you're trying to solve the problem should actually like it and should want to do it. Then comes viable, which is your company should actually or yourself should benefit, right? And once you have these two, you can always make it work by tweaking the idea, which is feasible, right? So that's why you need to pick an idea which is desirable, viable, feasible in that order. Now, what we will do here today is you will pick one idea. Doesn't matter which one you want to pick. As long as if you can pick something in this, fits in this, nothing like it. But I know that, you know, in 15 minutes time, it's not easy to come up with an idea which fits all of these three criteria. It takes time. It takes multiple iterations. So for today, we will pick one idea in each of your team, and we will do a prototype. So I'm sure you all know about what a prototype is, right? There can be multiple forms of prototypes. It can be a paper-based prototype. It can be Lego blocks. It could be wireframes. It could be flowcharts. It could be storyboards. It could be videos. It could be skits. It could be, you know, physically acting out the scenario. Doesn't matter which way. As long as you can present it to the user and the user can provide you feedback. So the only purpose of building a prototype is to collect feedback. That's it. End of chapter. Doesn't matter how you build the prototype. Doesn't matter what kind of prototype it is. As long as the user, when they interact with the prototype, can understand and give you feedback, it's good enough. Okay? In your case, it might be today in this room, it might be easier to develop a wireframe or a flow chart or a skit, you know, a small play kind of a thing where you play different characters of a process or a document or whatever you want to call it. So for example, I saw this performance one night in Jagriti theater where there was this singer, there was only one singer, she performed for 1.5 hours. The way she performed was she mimicked or she thought of herself as a mobile app. And the audience as the people who are using the mobile app. You know, the interface between a mobile app and its user. And she would present options. Users would pick options or click on wherever they want to. And based on what selection they make, she will then either sing, dance, perform, whatever. So you can use your imagination to create physical skits out of anything, right? So the idea is you get 15 minutes, number one, to pick an idea that you want to prototype, and number two, to build the prototype itself. Picking an idea, 1 minute, building the prototype, 14 minutes. I'm here, so if you want, I can come over if you want any feedback in terms of, you know, how do you go about building a prototype. You do not get to explain the prototype. Some teams have already done with their prototype. So if I can ask one of them, maybe you can come and show what you have done. Anyone who has completed their prototype, yes, please come. Guys, watch. Yeah. You're not allowed to explain what you have done. You can only show it to them. So who is the user you are trying to solve for? Is it the content writer, the consumer, end user? I am an end user. So then play a skit. Unless you get feedback from your user for whom you are trying to solve the problem, you will never know whether you have actually solved the problem or not. Guys, listen, focus here, please. You will get time to do another round of prototyping. So focus. So you have to present your idea to the user, and whatever feedback that they give, you can decide whether or not you want to incorporate it or not. Up to you. But when you are presenting the idea, you are not allowed to explain the idea. You are not allowed to, you know, if a user gives you a feedback, you are not allowed to say, no, but we did this, or we did it because of this. No explanations. No defending of your idea. You can make notes. The only thing that you can do when a user is giving you feedback is ask questions. And questions like the following. Can you please explain it a little more? Why do you say that? That's it. Probing questions, basically.
So, do we present an issue,
a
problem statement?
No. You say, okay, we are trying to make, for in this case, trying to make documentation fun. Here is the idea. Give us the feedback. That's it. So, yes, please. So, we have one prototype presentation now. So they're going to solve it for the end user. Can you give them the mic, please? I am the end user, okay?
Yep.
So I'll just keep it like this so that, you know, and I will probably, once I'm done, try and explain and give you feedback. Okay, a very clear feedback is I have no idea what this is. I can see it's a screen. There is a file, edit and view. Then there are folders. And then there are files which are getting copied or replicated. I have no idea what those mean. It could mean that, you know, you are prompting the user to go there and click there and then move documents. But I'm not sure. Okay? So that's the feedback that you've got. Now, whether you want to take the feedback in terms of, you know, whether you want to adjust the prototype, you want to change it, you want to add more features, you want to change it from being a paper-based to a skit or from being a paper-based to a flowchart or whatever, you can go ahead and do it. Yeah? Thank you.
So, question?
Yes.
Okay, so you understood what is there in the first row. Do you understand what is there in the second row?
So it's, I think it is new document, then there is a folder.
In general?
No.
No?
No.
Okay.
Yeah? Okay, thank you. Yeah. Yes. Yes. Guys, listen and watch.
My God, I have so many documents to complete and there are errors. This log file even doesn't show me where exactly the errors are. Over that, I have the comments to be fixed. The review comments from development team and publishing also is extremely slow.
Hey Rupa, what are you doing so late in the office today?
Guys, listen please.
I have a release and there's too much work to be done.
Oh, then I must remind you that as your editor, I use the latest tool and it's showing up that all of your content is not compliant to our style guide. Can you do something about that before you fix this, before you send it out for the release?
Sure, I'll rework on my content. I'm working so hard and it's been 11 o'clock. I still have no time to go home. My documents are not in a shape to be published.
So how did the release go, Rupa?
Oh, it was very hard. I put a lot of effort and finally it was done.
So was it the issue with all of you all? Okay, so I have a suggestion. Why don't we,
let's do some disruptive thinking and come back with a better way of doing our work.
Six months later.
Okay.
Product and you know what, I have learned so much in the whole process without getting involved into too much of complex writing and too much structure or anything around it, and I also am learning the product myself. This is awesome.
Likewise, I've been and creating animations and learning a whole lot of things about the product, and I'm able to help the others. I find time to help Rupa with her work.
Publishing is a lot more faster. In addition, it has excellent features wherein it can review the content on the go as soon as I write it. So life is much easier now.
I'm so glad that you've all done this. I'm going to take this back to our management and showcase this as our innovation team. Good job, team.
Okay, thank you. So obviously the user here was the content writer, right? And we have a room full of content writers. Right? Now I want some feedback to be given to this team. Is there anyone who can? Yes?
Their idea is that one person was overloaded with work while the others just looked at or gave her more work to do. And she was as such forced to take up things and rush into the final release.
Okay.
So after the manager engaged and involved the others, after 6 months, probably it got resolved because she was able to collaborate with the other team who are using a better tool than what she used. So,
okay.
It went
so,
better.
Okay. Anyone else has any feedback for the team? Think that you have a different version of understanding than what she said for the idea that was presented.
Usual writing process, they switched to a new process, new tool, and the customer was happy, they were happy. That's how things changed.
Okay. Anyone else has any feedback in terms of how the entire thing turned out? Yes, please.
I think before they were using different tool for publishing. I think after a brainstorming with the team, they have come up with a different tool, a whiteboarding tool, so that solved their problem. And the manager congratulated the team, and they call it as innovation.
Okay.
So I got that they were trying to solve an issue that was seen for the first release and it wasn't there. But how it happened, what was the process, and what got solved wasn't clear to me.
Okay, thank you. So my feedback is the following. You know, you showed that, okay, here is the current scenario. We did something, and this is the new scenario. Now, the entire point of doing the prototype is to show what is it that you did, and not the shift from the old scenario to the new scenario. So what you should have focused on was that switch that you made. You know, if it is a new tool, you should have shown the new tool. If it was a tool that you have developed, then you could have shown the look and feel of the new tool that you developed. If you wanted to show how using the tool helped her, you should have actually shown her using the tool. Right? That then gives people the ability to provide feedback. Otherwise, I was here, I was having a lot of problems. Now I did something, now I don't have any problems.
Now we're having fun.
And now we are having fun, yeah. Right?
So come back and do the sketch.
Yes. Yes. So the entire idea of design thinking centers on this fact. Guys, listen please. So the entire idea or the concept of design thinking is dependent on the fact that you do multiple iterations of whatever activity that you are doing. So whether it is user research, you can do multiple times for different users. Whether it is ideation, you can do it multiple times, coming up with different ideas. If it is prototyping again, you can continue to develop the same prototype, or you can pick a different idea and prototype that idea. You do it until you find something that works, that clicks. Right? Now I would suggest the following. I'll give you another 5 minutes for you to think through the prototype, including your team, and then you come and show what you have developed. In the next, after 5 minutes, do you need the 5 minutes or are you ready? Okay, then come over. You get 5 minutes to fine tune the idea and you will come back on stage and show it again.
Basically, I'm narrating. So we have a user who is trying to attend the design thinking session in STC conference. So let's see what he does. So here is the user. Okay, so he sees a locked door. Now he's confused of what to do. Let's see what he does. He's not able to open the door.
No, you can't narrate anymore. So you set the context. Now they have to figure out what is happening.
Okay. No, but he's connecting. I'm telling what he's doing.
People can see.
Okay, thanks. Do enact. Google.
Go ahead. You go ahead with the process. She will not speak, that's all.
He sees a task with all the steps. He reads the documents. The user reads the document.
Okay. I need a set of steps to do this task. Okay. Step one. Step two. What's this? What if I had a GIF to do this?
He needs the GIF to be more user friendly. When you can actually see how to unlock the key, here is the GIF.
That's a great idea.
So that's the point. So I said, when you say narration, you can set the context and that's it. Even that, you should try and avoid. What you can do is you can put up a name saying that I am a user. Someone can say, okay, I am the app. Someone can say, you know, I am the GIF. And so the idea is, as long as you don't have to explain and the user gets it, that is what you need to aspire for. And that is where you start also, right? So yes, you had something to say. So by the way, I still, I think the idea was, instead of giving documentation, give GIFs. Yeah, so but you're not supposed to defend or add to the idea, right? A very, very difficult thing to do, to not defend or explain the idea. Yeah. Okay? So this, you can maybe, you know, ask someone to come. Someone who's not interacted. If you want to come, come. So you're a technical writer, right?
Yeah.
So this is the flow chart that you've got. Just read through it. And tell us whether you've understood and what is your feedback. Read it loud so that people can also hear.
Okay. Document process improvement, requirement gathering, proposal board. Okay. Proposal business requirement document. From there, it goes to either the dev, QA, or the technical writer. Now, the technical writer gets the proposal business requirement document, and you get demos and meetings for it. And this is for a new technical writer who views this proposal. Okay, and along with the proposal, he also gets product knowledge, design document, the schedule, and the deadline. The QA, on the other hand, is taking care of development and. Can't understand it much.
Okay, so that's a very valid feedback. Thank you. That I was about to stop you and tell you exactly that you know, she is not able to follow. It could be because of your handwriting, it could be because the process itself is not clear, whatever. But the feedback is very clear that if you give this to an end user, the end user is not able to understand the idea. Okay, that's a feedback. Please take your seat. You want to do a prototype as well? You want to present something? No? Yes or no? Okay, come. You want to act?
Can I just tell?
This is for?
The
end user.
End user.
Okay.
So the end user is.
So let me just check and see if I'm able to understand. Okay, so guys, listen. There is a product screen. Or application screen, and then there is a chat box, and it says, "How can I help you?"
Okay, it's a chat box.
So you may understand it. I don't know whether it's a chatbot. It's just a chat screen. Right? Yeah. So I'm just saying that, you know, this is what my understanding as an end user. Now, what you can do if you want to showcase this and get good feedback is, instead of showing it like this, you should actually do multiple screens. So you say, oh, first screen is this. Second, after this, this happens. After this, this happens. After this, this happens. And this is how, when you get stuck, you actually want to chat with someone. You chat. This is how the response comes. And then you say, okay, underlying technology is something that automated, but this is the idea. So that way, someone can actually follow. Always remember a few things about prototyping. You know, one screen, one wireframe, one flowchart does not constitute a prototype. Okay? So you have to show the flow of information. You have to actually explain what the idea does. Please, have a seat. Right? The idea is to get feedback. So if you just show one screen, what feedback can I give you? I can tell you whether I understand it or not, or I can tell you that, you know, it looks good or not. Either ways, it doesn't help you. Right? So you have to explain the idea in a way that the user can actually give feedback. I'll tell you one example which should probably help you visualize what I mean by the entire exercise. How many of you are here are familiar with Palm Pilot as a product? One. Okay, so it was the first, probably the first mobile PDA that was successful in the market. Right? So the way it was designed, sorry? Yeah, I mean, subjective. Subjective, but I have used it and I liked it, so I will think it is successful. So the way it was designed was, the guy who designed it carried a wooden block, a block of wood, in his pocket, the size that the Palm Pilot was supposed to be for 1 week. So he knew that he wanted to have contacts, schedules, which means calendar, contact, and notes. So every time he had to take somebody's number, he would take this block of wood out and act as if he's entering the number. Every time someone asked for a meeting, he would take this block out and assume that he's actually looking at the calendar and actually scheduling a meeting. Same way, every time he wanted to make a note, he would take it out and act as if he's trying to make a note. And every time someone came and told, why can't we add this feature in this, take it out and show it to them and ask them, where and how will this feature fit? He did this for 1 week, and at the end of the week, they realized that, no, there is only these 3-4 things that it should ideally do and do well. And that is how the entire product got developed and delivered and shipped. Similar process is what a lot of software companies also today follow. They come out with small, tiny beta, alpha versions, and then, you know, iterate to go towards a better version of the product itself as they go along, as they continue to get user feedback. So Google does this as well. So what they do is, you know, they create something and then, you know, get this feedback. A lot of times, some of their feedback is very open and public. Right? And as users, we continue to provide feedback to the teams by the way we use and interact with the product. Right? So, we did this already as well. We did 2 rounds of prototyping. So you continue to do this as long as you get the desired result or desired feedback from the customer. Then you're ready for your alpha release. Or to try it out, right? Continue the process till you get it right enough to launch as a beta. So that kind of concludes what I had in store for today. A few things that I would like to reiterate. One is, design thinking as a methodology is great for solving complex problems which can have multitudes of solutions and has multiple levels of systems interacting with each other. It's human-centric. There's a method to the madness. Focus as much time as possible on the problem space, at least equal to the time that you spend in the solution space. Remember, once you have the right problem, finding the right solution is easier. Right? So when it comes to thinking, whether it is in design thinking or even in normal life, divergence and convergence is the best way to think for any problem solving. Always think in terms of diverging, which is creating more options, and then closing or converging to pick one of those options, right? Irrespective of which situation that you are in. Then, as I said, when you are doing ideation, brain dump, which is first do your ideation individually, then do group, so that you can avoid the influence of strong personalities and articulate personalities, and you get all the ideas on the table. It is easier to lean towards the extremes and then come to the middle, rather than start in the middle and go to the extremes. So as I had written in my slide, it's easier to make extremely creative idea more practical than to make a boring idea more interesting. So always lean on the extremes and then don't stop there. Move towards the center so that it becomes more practical as well, right? So prototype, 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 irrespective of what you do. I do prototyping all the time in my life as well, in everything that I do, and test it out with my son, with my wife, with my colleagues, with my boss. I keep testing, what works better. So you can do the same. In design thinking, it's even better, because then you are actually working towards something that actually has the possibility or probability of getting adopted. When you are looking at ideas, look at it from the desirability, viability, feasibility frame, and in that order. So desirability always comes first, because if the user don't like it, adoption will not be there, right? Same way, viable, if it is not profitable or makes sense for you or your organization, they will not adopt it. You can always make an impractical idea practical by adding elements or removing elements from it. So desirability, viability, feasibility. One last thought that I would like to leave you with is that one way to solve a problem, or rather the way I approach solving a problem, is first step is try and eliminate the problem. So think about what would the world look like if you eliminated the thing that is causing the problem. So for example, if in this case, making documentation fun, what happens if I remove documentation? So then there is a whole set of other things that you can think of that your mind has access to, right? So the second thing is, if I can't eliminate, I automate. Can I make it in a way that I don't have to do anything, but at the same time solves a problem? And then if both doesn't work or both are not feasible, then I look at doing all the other creative problem solving methodologies that we talk about. So I'll stop here and ask if there are any questions in what we did today, what we covered today. Maybe we have another 5 minutes to answer any questions that you might have. These are my coordinates. That's my website. Pushing Beyond the Obvious is my podcast where I interview thought leaders. I have 57 episodes live already. And this is my book that is already published, in the process of writing my second book.
Yes. Any questions, please?
Not necessarily. Not necessarily. When I say remove documentation, what can you replace it with? So you still need it. So what do you do? So fun is one element. So if I remove documentation, when I say documentation, I mean the text documentation. So if I remove that, if I do not have the constraint of thinking of documentation in a specific way, and still make it fun, and still make it work, what would those ideas be? You will find that the ideas that you will get will be completely different from otherwise. At least that's been my experience most of the times. Nothing is, fixed or all works all the time. I've seen that work. So for example, in my life, I always used to get complaints from my wife and from my colleagues that, I don't know how to match my trousers with my shirts. I'm colorblind, so I always had this problem. So what I did, I eliminated all colors from my life. I only wear a black shirt, simple. Irrespective of what trouser I wear, I only wear a black shirt. There is no thinking about, what shirt to wear with what trouser. Eliminated the problem. Same way, I'm diabetic, and I find that, I can't resist having rice and chapati, because those are the two most favorite dishes of mine. So what I did, I tried to restrict the quantities, didn't work. So now since 1st of December, I've eliminated rice, wheat and sugar from my life. I don't eat rice, I don't eat sugar, I don't eat wheat. Simple. So I eat dal, I eat dry fruits, I eat sabzi, just the sabzi. I eat anything that is made out of everything else but the three items that I've eliminated. So that way, if you find, you know, you can, once you decide that you want to eliminate, the way you think and the kind of solutions that you come up with, very, very different. So any questions?
Any other questions?
As I said in the start, no questions means? So I will take it the other way. So my physics professor also used to say, can be two reasons, or rather three reasons, why there are no questions. One, nobody understood a thing about what I spoke. Second is everyone understood everything about what I spoke. And third thing is, you know, people are not very open about asking questions. People feel shy, right, about asking questions. Okay, that's a new one. Thank you for giving that to me. Sure. So LinkedIn, Twitter, everywhere it's the same, R. Mukesh Gupta. The fourth, fifth iteration, you get to a point where you are able to address the problem enough to come up with a beta version. The process never stops. So once you have the beta version, you release it to the market, you continue the feedback mechanism. You continue to look at the other things. So I'll tell you one very interesting way to look at this. Let's assume that, you know, I am trying to develop a new product. I do a lot of research on a particular kind of users, for a particular kind of, in a particular kind of area. Now, I have solved one problem. Now, the user doesn't just have one problem. He might have other problems as well. So that then becomes my next product focus area. Once you solve that, then there is another thing that you can solve for the same user. What it also does is it creates a positive spiral. You already know the user so well that, you know, you can solve his problem, multiple problems. Plus, once you have solved his one problem, second time when you go back to the user is more than willing to provide you feedback and access, which is the most difficult thing. If you ask in this entire process, the most difficult thing is to get access and real feedback from the users. Because, you know, if you are developing for someone sitting in the US, it is difficult to get access to those guys. For example, if I'm developing something for CIOs or CEOs, getting time from the CEOs and getting feedback from them is not going to be an easy matter. So the more you understand them, their lives, the more you are able to solve their problems, the better your access to them gets, and it becomes easier as you go along. So the other thing about prototyping is that, you know, it helps you visualize. So once you do a prototype of a particular project or a particular idea, while doing the prototype itself, you will know that there are certain elements missing. While the very act of building the prototype will tell you what is missing, that you can then fix and add. So that also helps in speeding up the entire process. So if no further questions, I'd just like one or two of you maybe to give feedback, and then we can close about what you learned in the last 2.5 hours. Anyone, if you would like to. If you think that, you know, we're done, Mukesh, with you, thank you. We'd like to go back home and come back tomorrow fresh. That's okay as well.
As I told you before, I had read about design thinking, but, you know, couldn't understand the concepts. You understand some, but unless you practice the concept, you know, you don't really learn. So learning by doing is what makes the difference, and I think your workshop has helped us there.
Okay. They have written a book as to know how you can use the design thinking principles to actually design your life. So it's a great, it's a good book.
Yeah. So thank you for that.
Thank you. So my, by the way, my email ID is mgr. So all the South Indians will know the pun in there. So it's mgr@rmukeshgupta.com. So if you want to give feedback, please do send an email. I would appreciate if you can also tell me what I could have done differently or where I could have improved so that you could take back a lot more than what you did. Right? Thank you. I hope you had a good time.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Mr. Mukesh Gupta. I'd like to call our secretary, Padmaja, on stage to give away a token of applause. Thank you so much.
Thank you.